Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for your patience. Best laid plans, sometimes they fall apart in the end. My name is Matt Naylor, and I'm the President and CEO here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and we're delighted to greet you. Part of the programming series around this outstanding exhibition, John Singer Sargent Gassed. It was just now a couple of weeks ago that we opened the new Wiley Gallery, and what better exhibition than to have this remarkable John Singer Sargent piece together with a conversation around the detection and protection of chemical weapons in World War I and since. I don't know that the work, Bob, will have been exhibited in this fashion in any other place ever, and I find it really quite jarring to experience the work in amongst objects. So we're thrilled that perhaps one of the most enduring images from World War I, that being the use of chemical weapons, would be the feature of this new gallery, the Wiley Gallery. So if you haven't yet spent time in there and experienced the exhibition, I really strongly encourage you to do so. Other programming that we'll have on the 28th of March, Enduring Legacies of Gassed with David Carson, a photojournalist, a Pulitzer Prize-winning photojournalist, a war correspondent, Dr. Dean Gray, and Captain Tin Hornick will be together for a stimulating conversation. And then on April the 10th, Protection and Detection, Chemical Warfare, with the 14th Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, General Richard Myers, Dr. Tom Sack, the President and CEO of MRI Global, which is the largest chemical weapons detection agency in the United States, and Dr. Ron Truen from the National Bioagro Defense Facility at the Kansas State University. I think that's going to be really quite an outstanding conversation. More recently, Ron and General Myers were testifying at the Senate in their inquiry as to the use of chemical weapons. Just in the last couple of weeks, they've been in DC doing that. So it's a massively, enormously contemporary conversation, which of course is rooted in the work that we do here at the museum. So keep April 10th and March 28th on your programming schedule. Now to tonight, we're just delighted to introduce to us and have with us Bob Cozzolino, friend of the museum, a significant role in bringing gas to the United States, is the Patrick and Amy Butler Curator of Paintings at the Minneapolis Institute of Art. This wonderful book, catalog from the exhibition World War I and American Art. Bob, you're one of the authors of this. Are you the lead author of that? I don't want to downplay your... He's the author and general editor. So Bob wrote this book, fixed up the work of the contributing authors, and we'll be signing this afterwards. So we have just a small quantity. But I really would encourage you, if you're like us in our home, we have a bunch of books like this, and they're wonderful to spend time reading and enjoying, particularly in the winter months in Kansas City. So take advantage while Bob's here. Before being in Minneapolis, he was the senior curator and Evelyn and Will Kaplan curator of modern art at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts in Philadelphia. Has overseen more than 30 exhibitions, including the exhibition World War I and American Art, really has made an indelible contribution to American art scholarship, often referred to as the curator of the disposed, championing underrepresented artists and uncommon perspectives on well-known artists. So we're inviting a friend into our company tonight, and I know that you're going to very much enjoy Bob's presentation. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Bob Cozzolino to our conversation tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. First started coming to the National World War I Museum when I was starting to work on the show with my collaborators, David Lubin and Ann Knutson. And when I first came here, I was painfully aware of how little I knew about World War I in relation to all the other smarties in the room, not only those folks who work here, but also the amazing scholars across the board that I'm sure you have seen speak here, Michael Nyberg and Jay Winter and so on, and felt a little out of my depth. But despite that, I was really welcomed with open arms as a member of the family because of the project that I was working on, which, believe it or not, hadn't been done at all. No one has really looked at the impact of World War I on American artists until we did this exhibition that toured for about a year. And we did bring Gast over, the second time it's ever been in the United States in its history, for the exhibition. And the Imperial War Museum is generous enough and remarkably not using it until later this year in their centenary celebrations or commemorations to allow it to stay in the States for a little while longer. So I've been trying to drive people here, telling them that it's still in the United States before it goes back overseas. So you're in for a treat when you do see it. If I could have the lights down a little bit more, that would be great, Jake, please. So what I'm gonna do today is put the Sargent painting in context, and a specific context. I'm not gonna give you a whole history of how American artists have dealt with the First World War, although I'll give you a little bit of an overview of the different ways in, so you can see how Sargent's painting fits into that. But I'm really gonna talk about it in the context of how you do remembrance and how you deal with memory and the aftermath of a war, which is really what Sargent's painting is doing. War lingers. It's not simply the realm of those who experienced it firsthand. World War I has resurfaced in the work of many artists working today. In 2014, on the eve of the centennial of the war, artist Deborah Priestley made drawings of all 212 soldiers depicted in this photograph from her grandmother's collection. Her installation, the resulting work, is called Somewhere Listening, Company B, 365th Infantry Regiment, 92nd Division, AEF, 1918-1919. And it consists of vertical gessoed panels, each bearing a small graphite drawing, a portrait of one of the soldiers that were in that photograph. The 92nd Division was an African-American unit assembled from many different states and sent into combat in France during World War I. Priestley's great uncle served with them and is among the men portrayed. The translation from photograph to drawn image creates a haunting quiver, a tremor in the portraits. The faces hover in white space, as though looking out from another realm. There's a votive quality to the installation that makes the artwork, its form and presentation, and the familial connections inherent in its realization sacred. It enacts a meditative ritual of remembrance that honors the men, all of whom have since died. Now, when we started to work on this exhibition, there was a poll that came out. The exhibition opened in November of 2016 in Philadelphia, where people were asked, you know, what year did America enter the World War I? And you'll see that at the time, about as many people said they didn't know as got it right, and actually more people didn't know if you tallied it up or admitted that than actually got it right. So we knew that we had a lot of work cut out for ourselves. And I think this goes into why for at least American art historians and citizens, that World War I is still considered the forgotten war. So this is a page from The Onion, the satirical newspaper. This is actually from the book they put out called Our Dumb Century, in which they satirically went back to major events throughout the 20th century and imagined what their headlines would be like. And so this one is for World War I, war declared by all. Austria declares war on Serbia, declares war on Germany, declares war on France, declares war on Turkey, declares war on Russia, declares war on Bulgaria, declares war on Britain. Nations struggle to remember allies. And so, you know, that's, I think, goes to the core of why Americans are confused by it. But the graphic that this museum actually uses to explain the chain reaction is just as complicated. So it's not an easy war to figure out sort of why, you know, why did it begin? Scholars are still arguing about that and probably have on this stage in the last couple years. And unlike World War II, the average sort of school kid can't really tell you who the good guys and the bad guys are, or give sort of a Cliff's Notes answer about why we were fighting in the same way that World War I faces Americans. So thinking about all that, other reasons why it doesn't really loom large in the consciousness of Americans is that there's still no central Washington, D.C. based, mall-based monument, which still, you know, despite this being the major national monument that we're sitting in for World War I, Americans' consciousness gravitate towards our nation's capital and all the other kinds of monuments that are on that mall, and think of that as the place of pilgrimage. Rather than that, they're dispersed. There are monuments that are made at the local level. You can think of McKinsey's Doughboys. There's three of them in the state of Missouri. But also the work that Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney did, not only here but abroad, to memorialize the AEF, individual regiments at the local level in New York and other places. This is her AEF monument that's in France that was dedicated in 1926. And the other thing is that, there are pilgrimage sites basically in Europe for the American War and the War Dead. This is the Meuse-Argonne Cemetery, which is 130 and a half square acres, which contains the largest number of American war dead in Europe. And so for some, the sort of mourning that war really has its focus in Europe for many good reasons. And so it also happened, of course, on European soil. It was over there very much for a lot of Americans and continues to sort of have that in its consciousness. And in art, we can think of a lot of European artists who had successful careers or already making an impact before the war started, then were in uniform during the war, sometimes made art objects about their war experience during the war, and then afterwards continued to sort of work through the war. And those are, these are just a handful: Paul Klee, Guillaume Apollinaire, the poet, George Brock, Umberto Boccioni, people like Fernand Léger, Franz Marc, and others took part in the war. And we have these self-portraits by German artists who were in the war, all done in 1915. Ernst Ludwig Kirchner, self-portrait with this mutilated hand, which is not real, this is him projecting. Otto Dix, self-portrait as a target. And then Max Beckmann, who was a medical orderly during the war. And then all, of course, made work afterwards. And then the big commemorations, of course, that have an impact that have happened with artists have largely taken place somewhere else and have a particular context there. So this is a piece that's called Blood Swept Lands and Seas of Red that happened at the Tower of London in 2014. It marked 100 years since the first full day of Britain's involvement in the First World War. It was created by artists Paul Cummins and Tom Piper. And so 888,246 ceramic poppies were progressively filling the tower and its moat between 7th of July and 11th of November in 2014, each representing a British military fatality during the war. Can't really do anything that has that kind of an impact here in the States. And also there's this project, which is a beautifully realized project, which is called We're Here Because We're Here, which happened on July 1st, 2016, a piece by Jeremy Diller in the UK, in which it was a UK-wide event commemorating the over 19,000 men killed on the first day of battle, of the Battle of the Somme. And 1,400 participants each took the identity of a particular man who had died in that battle, and walked around the UK, were dispersed in different places amongst people in contemporary society, and when asked, would hand them a card that said the identity of that person. So you can't really imagine that kind of thing happening and having that same impact here, because the ghosts of the war don't really haunt the United States in the way that maybe the Vietnam War does. So what about Americans? Isn't their experience important and wouldn't it have given rise to really significant art? Well, of course, just to remind you, some of the reasons that are given for dismissing this by an art historian named Milton Brown, which was very powerful argument for a long time, was just a couple of lines in a significant survey book of modern art that said that it was really just an interlude and didn't have much of an effect on American art at all. And when we think about what that experience of the actual men who fought, some of them artists, were, we just have to remember that while we weren't in the fighting very long, the numbers don't really seem like they're significant compared to the European losses. 26,000 American soldiers lost their lives in a month's time during the most intense fighting of the Meuse-Argonne front and others in summer of 1918. And those losses accounted for half the combat deaths. So in a really tiny compressed amount of time, this intense sort of loss happens. And it was more than the Civil War battles of Antietam, Shiloh, Gettysburg, and Cold Harbor combined. So really, if that stretched out, you can think of how much that may have been compounded. And it's overshadowed in American art history by the impact of the International Exhibition of Modern Art, or otherwise known as the Armory Show, which happened in 1913 in New York, and then two-thirds of it went to Chicago and was shown at the Art Institute of Chicago, which, as you see, the installation here, and it's really claimed that that had the larger impact on American art. But what we found as we were digging in is that a lot of artists were going to go in this abstract way, or had been already, because of other kinds of influences in the world, not simply art. And people like Marsden Hartley, this is a piece that's at the Nelson Atkins, and it's on view right now with its handmade frame, were already in Berlin when the war broke out and had been working through modernist styles, and also were totally absorbed in and thinking about and influenced by the military processions and the climate around them, and registered in their work. And really, the greatest number of artists, a huge concentration of artists in the United States, working across styles, across generations, across political spectrum, did work in relation to the war, either officially or because personally they were invested in some way and wanted to give some kind of visual sense to what was going on, which was an unprecedented global catastrophe. So the way that artists got involved is James Montgomery Flagg, for instance, here in a publicity stunt, is with his poster, Tell That the Marines, with a model for that, and some Marines standing in to make it more colorful behind him. The Division of Pictorial Publicity in the United States, which was just instated just a few weeks after the war declaration, enabled American artists to go to work in the way that would really be a precursor to the New Deal art projects in the WPA during the 1930s. So you have artists of all different styles and backgrounds designing posters for recruitment intentions. And a lot of times these are playing really on a nerve, hitting gender issues and all sorts of other kinds of issues, hitting a spectrum of the broad public in order to really galvanize people and get them involved. Gee, I wish I were a man. This is a Howard Chandler Christie poster. I joined the Navy, so really a challenge to masculinity. And then this guy, who's really depicted as this sort of effete upper-class guy, who may decide to try to opt out in some way because of his position in society, is being faced with which side of the window are you on? What is your responsibility here? Shouldn't you get in line too? Other artists really up the ante in terms of apocalyptic imagery and showed what was at stake if we didn't get involved. This is Joseph Pennell's Lest Liberty Perish, and this is the original watercolor that he worked up before it was made into a poster. That shows an engulfed in flames Manhattan skyline with Lady Liberty's head there in the water. That's what's going to happen, that's what's at stake. And of course the visual culture of these things had a huge impact on the rest of the 20th century. So this poster from 1917 by Richard Fairweather Babcock, joined the Navy, the service for fighting men. This is about as phallic and sort of hyper-masculine as you could possibly be, to the point of almost being comedic and over the top. And certainly Stanley Kubrick thought so, because I think that it was probably a model for General King Kong riding the missile down and being part of the action in Dr. Strangelove, or How I Stopped Worrying and Loved the Bomb from 1964. There are countless examples of parodies of the James Montgomery Flagg 1917 I Want You poster. This is just one of them, which was done in 2002 by a group called Thomas Paine that was using that echo with Osama bin Laden's visage and saying, "Uncle Osama wants you to invade Iraq," sort of taunting that, "Go ahead, send me a new generations of recruits if you do that. That's what's going to happen here." So people have thought that this is potent imagery that American artists have to come up with from scratch, because they were never really involved in a kind of sort of visual culture process around a war in the same way. You have anti-war and sort of social criticism happening, sort of posters and drawings being published in individual magazines. This is a drawing that was made by an artist named Lorenzo Harris for The Crisis, which is an African-American magazine published in June 1917, really getting at the core of whether African-Americans who became part of the service and fought and went overseas fighting for democracy were going to be treated equally in return, if there was going to be any hope for that kind of turnaround in American society afterwards. And it says, "In spite of submarines here," the ship is the USS Negro Patriotism and Loyalty, "what's being born in here and threatening to sink it is prejudice, lynch law, and segregation." So you had a lot of artists who are not really sort of down with all the kinds of things that are happening around the war, making art about it. So in the Masses magazine, which was a leftist anti-war leaning magazine, you had artists like Robert Minor making this drawing, "Army Medical Examiner, at last a perfect soldier, will have no conscience about what's going to happen." And then here, "War, come on in America, the blood is fine." And this kind of work was deliberately sort of a contrast to the kinds of posters for recruitment that were happening. So you have Henry Glittenkamp's Physically Fit. This guy's certainly physically fit, but he's basically a foregone conclusion about what's going to happen, and the skeleton of death is measuring him for a coffin. This is the kind of work that got the Masses shut down in 1918 under the Espionage Act and then the Sedition Act. In fact, a lot of the artists for the Masses, some of them were brought up on charges, brought to court because of it. And so there were real consequences in wartime to be speaking out and making these kinds of images. Child Hassam, whose flag paintings you might know, they're very popular and they've been exhibited a lot in the last 10 years in different kinds of focus shows, was pro-interventionist. And he really did feel that these flag paintings that he was making, which seemed like beautiful impressionistic scenes, studies of light and the effect of wind on these flags and the busy city underneath, were really pro-interventionist kinds of imagery for America to get involved. And this painting in particular, Allies Day, May 1917, reproductions of it were sold for the war effort. So even imagery that you would think would be innocuous and not really be involved had a direct connection to the war, because the artist making them really felt that that's what would need to be connected. You had people like Morrison Hartley, who is sort of ambivalent and caught by surprise by the war, who, as I said, was in Berlin when the war broke out. It was teased about it by his own American counterparts. This is a Lee Simonson cartoon about Marsden adopting Germany, and there he is stepping in line with the Germans and wearing a uniform. But Hartley took it very seriously. He loved German culture, and he wanted to be accepted by the avant-garde there, who he met with and exhibited with. And he fell in love with a man named Karl von Freiberg, who was a German officer, and within the first few months of the war was killed at the front in 1914. And this painting, which is now in the Museum of Metropolitan Museum of Art, is Hartley's major memorial painting to him. It's really a lovingly crafted, almost like harking back to a medieval slab tomb, a portrait abstractly of Freiburg and his essence, the military uniforms that he wore, and gives little clues to his personality here and there with this stark back background. You had artists like George Bellows, who initially were anti-war and sort of interested in pacifism, even making drawings for the Masses magazine like that, reading the Bryce Report and then completely turning around and feeling like American involvement had to be 100% in order to stop the kinds of atrocities that were being reported on as the Germans went through Belgium and other places, whether those were accurate or not. And so instances that were well known, like the death of Edith Cavell, killed by firing squad by helping people of both sides and soldiers of the Allies escape occupied Belgium, was a print that he made after a drawing. He even made a painting based on it, and did a whole war series that's really still hard to look at, because Bellows was really angry about this and felt like he needed to shake people out of their complacency and become passionately involved in the war effort. So this is a large-scale painting that's 9 feet wide called The Germans Arrive. It's playing on this this theme that pops up in World War I imagery and art across the board in Europe and America, of hands being cut off, civilians, and civilians being targeted by the Germans. So Bellows made huge, large-scale paintings based on this. Then you had artists for whom the experience in the war changed their lives and changed their practice completely. Edward Steichen was the chief of the photographic section of the AEF from 1917 to 1919. And it forever changed how he thought about photography and what could be expected of it. There's Steichen with the group that he was supervising. This is an example of one of those photographs that he took. Prior to the war, he favored soft focus impressionistic effects in his camera and in his camera work. But afterwards, it had a crisp and precise look. And he later reflected, quote, "The wartime problem of making sharp, clear pictures from a vibrating, speeding plane 10 to 20,000 feet in the air had brought me a new kind of technical interest in photography. Now I wanted to know all that could be expected from this medium." And so his pictures had to be usable in surveillance and intelligence work, and the sort of problem of overcoming the issues involved in trying to get that crisp, clear photograph really excited Steichen, and it affected his peacetime work. This is the image of Vaux, which was photographed a lot and drawn by artists, with American troops entering right down there, just sort of in, I think Steichen was, with a lot of people, in awe of the destruction. Here's another photograph by Steichen showing you what the cratered landscape looked like. There was an unreality to a lot of these war images that also Steichen and some of the artists were amazed by. You had artists like Everett Langley Warner, who was making put to work doing camouflage design and supervising that. Here he is with people in Washington, D.C., and then just a couple of sheets showing you the designs of these things to completely baffle the enemy. And in practice, a color slide from the family's collection of one of these designs by Warner in practice. So there's practical work that artists are getting to. Then you have the AEF-8, the first official war artists who are embedded and are going overseas in order to be with the soldiers and to depict what's going on, what their experiences are like, not only in the middle of the fighting, but also in downtime between, like Harvey Dunn. This is an example of the work he was doing street fighting. This is George Harding, who's the only one of these guys who actually was an official war artist in World War II as well. Trained at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts in Philadelphia and then taught there. And his often take the viewpoint for the viewer of a soldier encountering the experience. So you're sort of in the trenches with them, and it's a soldier's viewpoint in order to really bring the visceral kind of experience close at hand. And then there's people like Anna Coleman Ladd, who are moved by humanitarian interests, got involved with the Red Cross, but also wanted to figure out a way to put her sculpting skills to work and design ways of helping to rehabilitate men who had been disfigured in the face after the war to assimilate back into society. And so she came up with ways of fixing tin masks onto their face in order to help them. Now, that gets us to Sargent. And so Sargent was sort of annoyed by the war, actually, initially. He had been painting in the Tyrol, and when the war broke out, it seemed like it was really just encroaching on his experience and was something that he didn't really want to have to deal with. He came back to the United States for a little while, and he's the artist, of course, of these great society pictures, Madame X, which is at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and Miss Fisk Warren and her daughter Rachel. So he's going around the Western Front with Henry Tonks, who's a British artist who had been making images of the war wounded like this at Aldershot Hospital in 1916. And what Sargent was really urged by some of his peers, like Henry James, friends of his in London, to get involved in some way. And he was officially commissioned to make a painting for a planned Hall of Remembrance for the end of the war. And so what he moves around, he tries to figure out if there's anything worth depicting, and he's frustrated over and over again. He doesn't really feel like there's anything worthy of a large-scale, mural-sized image. He's not finding anything. He makes these watercolors that seem to play up the absurdity and the strange juxtapositions of the war, like this one with this farmer in the field and a crashed airplane in the background there, as though this guy is a kind of specter or an echo of death. A sugar refinery that's been bombed out and destroyed and burnt and twisted around in the aftermath. He'd find scenes like this. But really what made it for Sargent and gave him the subject that he felt was worthy of his brush and a large-scale subject that would have resonance was an actual experience that he had. He came upon this scene that he witnessed in August of 1918 of British soldiers lined up, sort of 10 here and 10 here, each with their hands on the shoulder of their comrade in front of them in order to keep balance and to maintain contact with that person, who've all been the victims of a mustard gas attack. So they're all bandaged. Their eyes are bandaged, partly to keep out the light, but in some cases because of wounds. And you have this guy here who's leading them and calling out to them, and possibly it's been speculated he's calling this guy, reminding him to step up because he can't actually see the step here on the board. And then you have these other soldiers who are writhing around at the bottom of the picture, all of these figures almost life-size, not quite, and various states of distress. Some of them are passed out. Some of them simply seem to be relaxing. You have another group that's getting ready to evacuate here, and you see the lines of a tent that they're all walking towards where they're going to then be evacuated to go to a proper hospital. They're on the field right now. And then there's some details here that Sargent was really moved by. One is this vulnerability of this man who needs to be guided and has overextended that leg in anticipation of that step. Then you have this guy and this guy here who are sort of counterparts to one another, who are breaking line to retch. They're throwing up. They're vomiting because of the after effects of this poisoning that they've had. And they're being held up by these companions of theirs, their fellow soldiers. And so a lot of what really moved the British populace when they saw this unveiled after the war was the sensitivity with which Sargent managed to captured the interaction between these guys, their vulnerability, despite the fact that they were these heroes and these soldiers that had been through hell and had taken a lot. It really seemed to bring the costs of war to home. So for instance, one of the people who wrote about this after it was exhibited for the first time was Virginia Woolf, who pointed out in particular the figure of the man who's stepping up in an exaggerated way. And she said, reviewing the finished painting when it was exhibited in London, that the exaggerated step was likened to, quote, the final scratch of the surgeon's knife, which is said to hurt more than the whole operation. sort of woof. That seemed to sort of, something about that had this emotional resonance. You know, these men's lives are changed most likely for the forever. Some would probably recover, but a lot of them would have lingering after effects that would affect their health for the rest of the life. And of course, the other things that are unspoken here are the things that they saw before they are either temporarily or permanently blinded by the effects of the gas. Now, it's a huge painting, so that's also part of its impact. It's 20 feet wide, which you'll see when you're able to see it. This is just an image of it being loaded in Europe before it came overseas to our exhibition in Philadelphia, and it travels out of its frame, but in this special crate that's made for it. And in the gallery in Philadelphia, we hung it almost at floor level, so that it really felt like you were being absorbed into the picture, or that you could walk into it, and that the viewpoint that Sargent took, which seems like it's him coming upon that scene with Henry Tonks and being an eyewitness and experiencing the panorama of the wounded, really gets at you and pulls you in. Now, there's some other details in here that are very unusual. First of all, many people have noted that the entire painting seems to be infused with this sort of mustard yellow. And in reality, when it's lit properly, as it is here, by Doran Cart and all the lovely staff here, it brings out a lot more color than you see in this reproduction. So this reproduction, as with most reproductions of art, is lying to you, even though we have a great projector working here. But it's actually the yellow is really located on the bodies of the men, as though it sort of permeated them. But the rest of the painting has a richness of color that is really surprising. The whole middle has a kind of pink and turquoise. And so what we know is that Sargent is depicting a particular time of day. It's sunset. And so that could be allegorical, that it's sort of the end of things. In the very background, there are there are soccer players. So there are healthy soldiers who are out of uniform who are actually playing a game of soccer in the background. And so one of the things that Sargent could be suggesting here is that life is going to go on, that for these guys, life is maybe temporarily interrupted or could be permanently changed, but for others, they've escaped that, and it's sort of a luck of the draw to some extent. There's a dogfight happening up in the sky above these guys, so there's active battle still happening while these people are being evacuated. And so other sort of dimensions to this. We know that Sargent isn't making it up. We have his account. But we also have other accounts of the way that the standard procedure for evacuating temporarily blinded soldiers was. We have these photographs also, so we know that Sargent isn't taking as many artistic license sort of liberties that you would expect. He's also, though, thinking about art history and thinking how to structure a scene that he's witnessed. And he's thinking about the parable of the blind leading the blind, which is by Bruegel, Jean Bruegel, and was done in the 16th century, all falling down together. Now, is he making that comment about the soldiers? I don't think so. I think that the suggestion here, in some way, is a kind of allegory of not only physical blindness, but moral blindness. After all, by the end of the war, a lot of people had been disillusioned. In the middle of the war, there was war poetry by British soldiers that was really critical of whether there was even a point to the fighting. And in particular, I want to just quote Wilfred Owen, which in a poem about death by poison gas, Dulce et decorum est pro patria mori, it is sweet and fitting to die for one's country. He wrote, if in some smothering dreams you too could pace behind the wagon that we flung him in and watch the wide eyes writhing in his face, his hanging face like a devil sick of sin, you could hear at every jolt the blood come gargling out of the froth-corrupted lungs, obscene as cancer, bitter as cud, of vile incurable sores on innocent tongues. My friend, you would not tell with such high zest to children ardent for some desperate glory the old lie, dulce et decorum est, pro patria mori. So Is that what Sargent's getting at here? He was really quiet about that. And some people have sort of poked at this painting and said, it really doesn't go far enough if it's an indictment of war. But I think really what's concerning Sargent here is the human cost of war. And not only the human cost of war, but the humanity that basically nurses in the medical field is going to take over and sort of deal with for trying to rehabilitate these guys. So there's many different levels to read this painting on, but whether it's an anti-war painting is sort of up in the air, but it's certainly in the context in which it was made, connected to other kinds of British criticism of the war, seems to fit in some ways. Now, thinking about the after effects of the war, the impact of the war, and the lingering sort of wounds, and how artists deal with them, I'm going to talk about some other artists that were contemporaries of Sargent and were based in the United States. Now, Sargent was an American, but he really lived an expatriate existence and is really claimed by the British, was commissioned by the British. But there's other artists who worked through the effects of the war and their experience in the war privately later on. For instance, Horace Pippin. This is Horace Pippin here. Horace Pippin enlisted in 1917, and he was in the 369th Regiment Army, which some of you will recognize as the Harlem Hellfighters. That's some of the group there. And Pippin was wounded in the Meuse-Argonne offensive. And he and his friend of his were racing from shell hole to shell hole under fire. This is a war memoir that he dictated and then illustrated, that's at the Archives of American Art in Washington, D.C. And he was hit in the shoulder by fire and fell into a shell hole. And a French soldier who was running with him was shot in the head and fell on top of Pippin. And Pippin was so weak from loss of blood that he was sort of trapped under this soldier, a horrific incident. But eventually was evacuated. And later on, about a decade later, really, as he was part of his rehabilitation and ongoing physical therapy, went back to art making. He had made art earlier, but was very serious about it later on, and actually became an exhibiting artist and bought by major collectors around the United States. This is an example of that. This is a 1935 painting called Dogfight Over the Trenches, in which Pippin is thinking about, you know, showing us the intimate experience of being a soldier in the war. This is a dugout trench here. Fighting is here. There's always the threat that it's going to move towards you. You can see that there's an entry into the ground there, and there's a makeshift grave from one of the soldiers, we presume. This is another painting that he made in 1930 to 1933 or so, called The End of the War, Coming Home. And it's unique in Pippin's body of work because it also includes this hand-carved frame in which, like reliquary objects almost, he is carved in all these different images associated with combat, the distinctive potato masher, grenade, rifles, the tracks of a tank, another kind of grenade, helmets, and so on. And so the whole thing becomes almost this sort of shrine to his war experience, in particular, triumphant experiences, the Harlem Hellfighters routing out these Germans' machine gun nests out of the trenches. And then eventually coming home, decorated by the French rather than the United States in the end. Claggett Wilson is an artist who's not very well known, but received a lot of attention in this exhibition. He was an artist who was a Marine. He was a lieutenant, and he was wounded, like Pippin, in the Battle of Belleau Wood in the summer of 1918. He was the victim of a poison gas attack and stranded in no man's land for 3 days before being rescued. And afterwards, what he did is he was based in American-occupied Germany on the Rhine, and he made a series of watercolors that is really about the soldier's experience and about his visceral experience of being in battle and witnessing all sorts of different kinds of horrors, but also surreal, strange events on the battlefield. And they're impeccably well designed. They're not very big watercolors, but they each have this huge impact. This, for instance, like all of them, has a sort of a narrative title. So they're not simple titles. This one is called Runner Through the Barrage, Bois de Belleau, Chateau Terry Sector, His Arm Shot Away, His Mind Gone. So this is done in 1919, but what it immediately makes me think of is a later image that's much more better known by Tom Lee called The Marines Call It the 2,000-Yard Stare, which was done in 1944, so a World War II image, done for Life magazine as a correspondent. That kind of image of shell shock and being emotionally detached from this too horrific experience that you're in, obviously Claggett-Wilson as a soldier had seen it. And it's already there in this sort of burgeoning visual culture of war that Americans are dealing with out of their World War experience firsthand. Other images by Claggett-Wilson are this remarkable painting called Symphony of Terror, also done in 1919, again right after the war. And you see there's a lot of different sort of washes and layers in this picture, but basically you see this ghostly wall of soldiers, enemy soldiers coming at the Americans in these gas masks, approaching through the ever-present twisted barbed wire that Claggett-Wilson has done in this exciting line work. Then you have this painting, Frontline Stuff. Again, soldiers wounded, getting ready to throw a grenade back, this guy cowering in fear. And then the bomb explosions also have these strange shadow figures in them, as though they're these attenuated bodies that are coursing through the air. This one's called Dance of Death, a nod to the medieval subject that is depicted not only in artwork, but carved onto cathedrals. But it's soldiers twisted up on barbed wire. And then this painting, done in 1919, which really brings home what Wilson's sort of intent was here for the viewer. This painting is called Flower of Death, the bursting of a heavy shell, not as it looks, but as it feels, sounds, and smells. And so it's remarkable formally because of how daring it is in terms of the articulation of the blast, with all these lines going back and forth, and then these paint spatters that are in the center and then start to radiate out and get more smeared as they come out. So he's using this formal language of abstraction to paint a visceral, tangible experience of being under this shell. And then in the bottom left corner, you have somebody trying to rescue a fellow soldier. Now, another artist for whom the war was hugely important was this guy, Ivan Albright, there with his twin brother, Malvin. And Ivan Albright was based in Chicago, and he enlisted with Malvin, his twin brother, in 1918, and was sent to France and spent the entire war experience that he had depicting wounds for surgeons at a base hospital, Base Hospital 11. And these are some photographs that Albright took during his time in France, interested and attracted by the ruins, and also probably astonished by the devastation in the landscape, but also to cities. And this is a photograph he took of the ward that he was on. And so the resulting images that Albright made, which are all done in these sketchbooks, almost always have an image of the wound on the right side in a folded out sketchbook, where he signs and dates exactly when he's doing it, and he calls himself medical drawer, the serial number of the patient and their name and their ID, but then a corresponding x-ray of that exact same place. So we're not really sure what the surgeons were getting at here, what they wanted exactly out of Albright's sketches. There was photography certainly at the time that could have been used, but Albright was making clinical, sort of emotionally detached images of the wounds. And he did this over and over and over again and considered it a job to do. In fact, one of the things he said about it afterwards is that even though he sort of downplayed this experience in his career later, he said, you know, the images of what happened with limbs, for instance, that were amputated never left him. He recalled, quote, one morning before an operation, I was in the washroom just outside the operating room, and there was a hand sticking out of the waste paper basket. You know, you'd bury those later. but you get used to that. So this was Albright's war experience, you know, not in battle, but actually hearing bombs bursting and battle nearby, but it was not an option for him to look away from any of this stuff. He had to look intently at the casualties of war, talk to the patients probably sometimes, and hear their story. And so he was getting this very specific kind of experience and drew them over and over again. And some of these, despite their subject matter, are very beautiful in terms of their execution. And you can see that Albright is getting into the delineation of colors and line and the viscousness of the insides of the body. In here, this is actually a German soldier who's being treated. This is a piece of shrapnel that Albright drew that presumably had been removed from this person's posterior. And then a couple more examples of the kinds of things that Albright saw. Now, just as important to him, and perhaps more important in terms of his formative experience, was that he not only remarked that seeing the magic eye of X-rays was hugely important to him, which he had never experienced before, but he actually watched these catastrophic wounded men come in with their sides opened up and being saved, basically, by surgeons, and the body healing itself. So there are many cases in which there's a soldier who came in with a wound like this, and then many weeks later, a couple weeks later, Albright follows up, and he shows how something is healing. So something about that stuck with him. And when he went on to make figure paintings in the 1930s and onward, people looked at these paintings and thought of them as macabre and really only about death. But I would argue, in looking at the kinds of spiritualist philosophies that Albright wrote about in the 1920s, that it was that latter part of the war experience, not just the wounded, the vulnerable body, but the capacity of the body to heal itself. There were unseen forces within the body that were sealing the body up and regenerating cells and doing that kind of work that led him to try to investigate spirit and matter in the presence of one thing and see the body as our earthen shelter, as he put it. And the real part of and the real essence of who we are is the spirit that's intangible. And Albright tried paradoxically to paint these hyper-real images with this intense focus on physicality in order to penetrate matter and to suggest that there's something else besides this sort of weak machine. I'll just go forward to this painting, which he does later in life in 1966 to 1977. It took him 11 years to paint because it makes that point really clear that Albright thought of this guy who is actually a member of the Vermont House of Representatives named Kenneth Hayes Atwood, who was sitting for him in Vermont, where Albright wound up living after being in Chicago for most of his career. Close to death, in fact, he died while Albright was painting him. Albright did take a long time to paint. But one of the things that he gets at in this painting, which has the title, "If Life Were Life, There Would Be No Death," is, as you see, these peculiar little color halos that seem to be rising out of this guy's body. So later on, Albright, who's really interested in this search for spirituality in the physical, seems to get it later in life and seems to find an appropriate form for that by having these little color halos and lights emerging out of this guy's body as though we're seeing the ascent of the soul or something mysterious that's coming out of what Albright called a kind of cocoon. Now, if that's really far out to you, all of this kind of spiritualist language was really intensely popular during the war and in the wake of the war. This is what was a popular postcard at the time called A Kiss from the Trench that shows a dead soldier who's come back to kiss his sweetheart who's by the fire at home, on the home front. And in times of war, like the American Civil War, there were these spikes and resurgence in spiritualism in an attempt to try to contact the dead. This is a photograph that William Mumler took of Mary Todd Lincoln that happens to have the ghost of Lincoln behind her, or not, depending on your viewpoint. And certainly people took him to court to dispute that, but not that specifically. And this is a painting by Emanuel Leutze, who's perhaps best known for his monumental painting of Washington crossing the Delaware. But it's an 1864 painting that he did during the Civil War. That's called Angel on the Battlefield. And if you look closely, you can see that what's happening is the souls of the dead in the Civil War are rising up and shown almost as innocent little children who are naked to form a kind of circle, not quite corporeal, mostly smoke or some kind of essence, who's writing their names in this book. And so this is a kind of imagery that during the First World War, and in particular in France, Britain, and the United States, winds up generating a new kind of imagery because of so much loss and because of this this broken connection where families weren't able to have a kind of resolution to loved ones dying far away without any kind of opportunity to say goodbye. This is a Claggett-Wilson painting from that series showing three saints of France rising up from the battlefield and then the hands of soldiers rising up with them from the battlefield. And so you also have images like this done by an Australian photographer called Death's Highway, an exposed road in the battlefield near Ypres from 1917, because there were a lot of accounts by soldiers of paranormal and supernatural things happening on the battlefield, things that seemed to exceed reality so much that one of the explanations that they came up with is it had to have some kind of other cause. Because what they were seeing was so unusual and intense and beyond their experience. You know, artists afterwards trying to give a visual image of loss, like Karl Hochner, a German immigrant based in Chicago, who makes this painting in 1918 and 1919, called The Homecoming of 1918, in which we see, you know, wounded, probably civilians, coming towards us in an endless sea, beckoning towards us for this not to happen again, but also to not be forgotten, to be remembered. And are they ghosts? Are they revenants? Are they real? Or are they actually refugees coming out of displaced towns? This is a photograph by a medium in Britain named Ada Emma Dean called Silence, and it purports to show a crowd above in Whitehall in London observing 2 minutes of silence on Armistice Day in 1922 with apparitions of all of their loved ones forming afterwards. So whether you believe any of this stuff or not, it generated this kind of craze and this will to have images of the dead return. This is a Norman Rockwell painting from 1920 that just sort of shows you how popular this was. These are a couple who are spending their daytime playing with a Ouija board. There's all sorts of material culture that came up to support this stuff in the wake of the war. Ouija boards, talking boards, planchettes in which a spirit would guide the hand and bring a secret message in automatic writing from the unknown. Spirit trumpets that mediums used in order to hear the voices of the dead come back and talk to them. And so just a few more examples of how this dovetailed with the way American artists were dealing with how to visualize loss in the wake of the war. And perhaps an unexpected example of this is Georgia O'Keeffe, who I'm sure you have all heard of. When Georgia O'Keeffe's brother Alexis enlisted in the AEF, she wrote to photographer Paul Strand, "I saw my brother in Chicago. He is enlisted in an officer's camp of engineers at Fort Sheridan, is hoping to be one of the first from there to go to France, and doesn't expect to return if he goes. A sober, serious willingness. It's appalling. He's changed much, and it makes me stand still and wonder, a sort of awe. He was the sort that used to seem like a large wind when he came into the house." So this is a watercolor that O'Keeffe made after visiting him in basic training that shows a flag sort of bleeding into the sky, sort of trembling to sort of echo her emotion that she talked about. But this is a painting that she did in probably about 1930, although it's been dated earlier. When he did return after serving overseas in the 32nd Division of the AEF, he had suffered war wounds. His heart and lungs were damaged by gas, and that would affect him for the rest of his life. O'Keeffe made this painting, Abstraction Alexis, which shows a swelling succession of clouds billowing up from a halfway point between the center of the painting and the bottom. and they're bordered by parallel wavy lines down here that run horizontally. As the clouds expand and rise outward, their edges take on a border of soot, making a startling contrast with the bright spots of white that suggest a light source behind the clouds. At the outermost top of corners, the clouds are consumed in a red glow. In the bottom right and left, it seems that there's a robin's egg blue just sort of edging out here, and the color of the space between the late wavy lines is that in the actual painting, when you see it, of dried blood. So he died on January 7th, 1930, from complications stemming from those war ravages on his body. And O'Keeffe showed this that year in her solo show in New York. And it's tempting to see this as a votive, perhaps acknowledging the way Alexis's short life had been affected by the gas attack after the war. Her description to Paul Strand, her friend, of Alex as a large wind seems to resonate in this painting as the clouds of gas appear to swell and dissipate. Encountering the painting, titled as it was, just after Alexis's death, would have colored its reception and meaning. It became a kind of memorial painting to him. But what's being commemorated here? A means of slow death? Or perhaps it's O'Keeffe's vision of how she wished to remember her beloved brother as a breath of fresh air filling his environment as spirit, feeling of him rather than the physical body. Other artists had to wrestle with how to depict the dead for families. Violet Oakley, based in Philadelphia, made this painting. How do you memorialize a soldier who suffered a violent death in the war? And one sort of solution to that is this portrait that Violet Oakley made of Henry Howard Houston Woodward, made 3 years after his death at the request of his parents. He had been in the American Field Service and served in France in 1917, and then before the Americans entered the war. And then he joined an ambulance section, and eventually he was in the service of the French Army as a fighter pilot with the Escadrille Spad 94 at the front. And on April 1st, 1918, he was reported missing in action, and the remains of his plane and body were found only a year later. So Oakley made several studies. Here's just the Lafayette Escadrille together. Woodward is not part of this group in that photograph, although that was what he was flying with. She made a number of studies, but the penultimate one is this one that she drew on canvas and kept erasing parts of the body. And it seems that she was toying with this idea of absence and presence, and ultimately felt like it was not appropriate to emphasize absence, but really wanted this healthy physical presence of Woodward to be remembered by the family. And ultimately, I feel like she structured this, an artist who is very much aware of religious painting and did her own religious painting commissions, as though he's like a martyred saint in front of the instrument of his martyrdom, this plane that he was flying after all that got shot out of the sky and then spiraled down to crash. Finally, I want to end with a Kansas artist. And then take questions. This is John Stewart Curry's The Return of Private Davis from the Argonne, which some of you may know. It depicts the ceremonial reburial of the remains of his high school friend, Curry's high school friend, William L. Davis, which had been returned from Europe in 1921, 3 years after the young man's death. Although Curry claimed to have been present at the memorial, he didn't begin painting the work until after a 1927 visit to an American war cemetery on the Western Front in France. When Curry's brother Paul died suddenly after his return from Europe, all three events may have commingled to make the subject more urgent to Curry. It's curious that he took this painting subject up 7 years after that death, and then started working on an image of Davis being buried from the vantage point of being at the graveside memorial, and then didn't finish it for another 12 years. Such a delayed reaction was a common instance among those in mourning and those who had experienced the war firsthand. And in Curry's painting, death and absence are expressed indirectly through the composition's displaced focal point. We don't look down on Davis's flag-draped coffin from a huge sort of high-up bird's-eye viewpoint, but in some ways, that horizon with the light and the clouds processing there is sort of the focus of our attention. Pulling our attention away from the materiality of the funeral process towards the mystical rays of light and the intangibility of that horizon. So is this a hopeful image? What are we supposed to contemplate here? The infinite and the implications of mortality by looking over humanity's concerns towards a cosmological order? It may have been Curry's way of working through his own survivor guilt about the war, because he narrowly missed the deadline for enlisting, and by the time he was drafted, the war was nearly over and he never left the United States. While his friend Davis enlisted immediately and was tragically killed on his first night of watch in Alsace, not the Argonne, although that's what Curry titled the picture after, you know, the sort of intense battle that the Americans were in. Private Davis's belated funeral may have served multiple functions in a complex mourning process that affected not only his hometown, community of Winchester, Kansas, his friend Curry, but also those who witnessed the painting in the 1940s as the United States entered another war. So I'm leaving you with this uplifting image, done in 1938, also by Curry, Parade to War Allegory, which he painted on the eve of the Second World War. And it just shows that for American artists, the macabre had become a kind of shorthand for the legacy of the First World War, as the soldiers' faces had already been transformed into skulls. They march in doughboy outfits, and their deaths are kind of a foregone conclusion amidst this celebratory send-off. This woman here, seems to be the only one aware of that, and maybe she is of a generation that witnessed the First World War, because Curry and others, troubled by contemporary events in Europe by 1938, worried that a new generation had grown up into a kind of walking dead destined for another charnel house. The meaning and profound impact of loss stemming from the war consumed many artists after the armistice was signed in 1918. Even as stone and bronze memorials were being erected around the country to provide public sites of remembrance for the fallen, artists explored personal and private ways to come to terms with the dead. Thank you. So, I'd be willing to take some questions.
We have time for two questions, so if folks would like to come to either microphone, or I can also come to you.
Thank you for a very interesting lecture. Just want to share a thought with you. The first time I saw Sargent's gas was about 33 years ago in the Imperial War Museum in London, and it was a war artist conference. And as a young man, I didn't appreciate the feeling and the implication behind it as much as I do today. And I'm surprised that it affected me equally as 33 years ago when I first stood in front of this. So there's some timeless quality about pain, war, and death in general.
Yeah, I think so.
One thing that I never quite figured out was the soccer players in the background. I'm wondering if that is a reference to the 1914 Christmas Day.
You know, that's an interesting comment. I don't know that anybody's really written about that aspect of it, but you know, it could be. We're not really sure, you know, what he intended by that exactly. A lot of people have speculated. I think, you know, colleagues of mine have written that in a way it's sort of suggesting this continuity, that there are these healthy bodies in the background that are going to sort of continue and have other kinds of experiences that are contrasting with the wounded men. But what you say is entirely valid, that it could be a reference to this Christmas truce. I don't know. That's a good point. Yeah.
Well, actually, in reference to that, I was going to have a question, and I thought during your lecture you answered it for me, but maybe I bring it up again. Because when I saw the painting of John Singer Sargent, I was totally fascinated by the moon coming up, almost fixated. It had to be for a purpose, because, the artists have purposes and everything. And I thought you had answered it with the soccer game. because you said in the soccer game that that was like a invitation for the future, for the ones that would go on and be healed and go forth. And now, and I thought, well, that's why the moon is there, because that's for the people that is going into nighttime mm-hmm. that can never be able to see again. And so, you know, it made the whole picture from one side to the other an emotion of humanity for the soldiers, not any kind of statement of social thing, but for the people themselves, the people that are going to go on with life unaffected and be able to continue, and the ones that will go through life scarred and hurt and blinded, you know, going into night. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, does that make sense, or?
Yeah, I think the more you scrutinize this picture, you start to see that there are these, this sort of call and response aspect to the way it's designed. So there are these tents in the background here that have a counterpoint here, sort of, if we're thinking filmically off screen. This group of people has their counterpart in these guys, and then even this register of wounded has another layer that's past that wooden slatted platform here, but also they're contrasted with those who are standing up. And then, as you point out, the ball that's in the air here, right here, that round form is sort of having this sort of distant counterpart to the moon. And I also do think that, you know, it's deliberate that it's a particular time of day that Sargent is depicting, when the sun is going down and you can see those shadows starting to become longer, and a particular tone to the sky, which you'll see in the actual painting. And so all of those things, I think, as you say, they're deliberate. Artists are thinking about how to compose something, especially something that monumental, that it's well thought out. And so I think it's built into the meaning of that picture.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful, yes. If you have additional questions, Bob will be in our lobby for a book signing after our program ends. So thank you, everyone, for joining us here at your National World War I Museum Memorial. Let's have another round of applause for Dr. Bob Cozzolino.